Domestic violence is a problem of huge proportion globally, that it affects primarily women, and that it accounts for the lion's share of violence faced by women. We also know about reports about domestic violence increasing around the world during the COVID-19 pandemic. This is a picture from a UNDP report that tells about a quite sizable increase in violence against women and domestic violence more generally, a bit everywhere. There's been quite a bit of media focus and talk of a shadow pandemic. Although we know that it's not so obvious to draw conclusions from just comparisons over time, and therefore we need research. And careful research into what is really happening and why, so what's driving it, is important, of course, to inform policy reactions immediately, just like Ria's paper's motivation was about, informing directly policy response, but also in the longer run, right? Because what we learn from these rather special conditions that the pandemic is creating can help us understand more generally how the phenomenon of domestic violence is working, hopefully unpack some of the causal mechanisms that are perhaps still open questions in the literature, and it can help fight it even when the pandemic is over. And Sweden can be a particularly interesting case for at least two reasons. So on one hand, Sweden tops all the international rankings on gender equality, right, in different dimensions, and it has seen as being having really advanced progressive norms and attitudes in this area. And we know that underlying norms and attitudes play probably a major role in mediating the role of other factors that impact domestic violence, right? So looking at the case of Sweden can provide a useful comparison to cases of countries where attitudes and norms are different. And moreover, so Sweden famously went its own way when it comes to contagion management. I write exceptional, I don't mean that necessarily in a commendatory way. This has been all over the press, right? The Swedish strategy has relied more than anywhere else on a voluntary basis, where the public has certainly been urged to keep the distance, to avoid crowds, encouraged to work from home, to avoid public transport, but never prevented or even discouraged from leaving their home, which makes a significant difference for the mechanisms that in other cases are believed to have led or at least contributed to the increase in violence. Okay, so what are these mechanisms? Of course, we've already seen this back and forth in many other introductions, but I still want to give my quick organization, right? So there's the big corpus of studies that focus on bargaining within the household, and then we focus on factors such as relative income, relative employment status, relative unemployment, but also status of women in society, which can be improved or worsened by using, for example, role modeling and representation in key roles. Then there is the alternative focus could be alternative or complementary focus could be on the more emotional and irrational nature of this phenomenon, where there is a focus on the negative emotional shocks, like for example an unexpected negative outcome of an important football match. It could be a layoff just as well. And where, of course, stress and uncertainty play a big role in shaping the overall emotional environment within the household. And where economic conditions are often a big part of this stress and uncertainty in the household. And then there is a widespread belief that violence increases when families are together for holidays or vacations. This follows the so-called exposure model that was mentioned also in some presentations today, and that is borrowed from the criminology literature. The evidence here is still weak, but this is precisely one of the areas where this pandemic can contribute with filling the knowledge gaps. Because, for example, the fact that many households with full wages have been forced at home it can help investigate just this channel in isolation from other channels that are, for example, the economic factors. And then the opposite of exposures, we could say, is what is known as incapacitation or self-incapacitation. And here we have examples of studies that look into what happens to crime rates when potential perpetrators are in jail, are in school, but also at the cinema, and when they have access to a legal prostitution market, as opposed to when they have not. So the presentation that should have been in the morning was precisely about this. What did we learn so far from studies from the very latest months then? I consciously didn't include here the studies that are in the workshop. These are only studies that are not in the workshop, but very quickly I want to point out that evidence seems to point from these studies to the importance of spending time at home at the same time, and the reverse of that, spending less time or having restricted mobility outdoors and in public spaces. This has been shown both for India and Peru, where the regulation was differentiated across different states. Also a study from the US proves the spent at home as captured by GPS data. And here, Leslie and Wilson, they also are careful to point out that these increases happen for all socioeconomic groups, which in their view weakens the relevance of more structural factors. And then there are, of course, studies with mixed or no results. I want to point out here in particular too, a study from Mexico City that finds no effect of the alcohol prohibition that was implemented in some of the districts in the city, and also a study from Canada that finds no effect of unemployment or working arrangement, but it does find an effect of financial uncertainty. Okay, so with this background, let's talk a little bit about what happened in Sweden, and I want to reiterate here that I'm mostly going to have descriptives and correlations and just throw out hypotheses and ideas. Don't expect too much, and please shoot away comments and questions. So as a little bit of background, the Swedish Council for the Prevention of Crime, BRÅ, estimates that roughly 7% of the Swedish population is exposed annually to crimes within the family. And men and women are roughly exposed equally. However, it is much more common for women to be exposed to more serious physical violence that require, for example, hospitalization as a consequence. And it is much more common for women to report also recurring violence. Okay, so there's roughly equal prevalence, but different extent. And when it comes to reporting during the pandemic, right, some crimes can be reported online in Sweden if you have a social security number, but this is not true for crimes against the person. This must always be reported on the phone to the police, calling the police or visiting a police station. So there might be concerns that then reporting to the police becomes more difficult during the pandemic, even in the absence of a lockdown. We'll see why. And in fact, total crimes reported in March to the police were 4% lower than the corresponding month last year. Nevertheless, there was a lot of variation by type of crimes. And for example, violent assaults against women were still 9% up compared to March 2019. Also, if you look as a whole to the first half of the year, total crimes seemed reported are 1% higher than the same period previous year. And once again, there is variation, but violent assaults seem to be reported violent assaults seem to be more than previous year. So in the face of an increase, I would say at least we hope that even with the underreporting, we can still be talking about lower bound, hopefully. Okay, so Sweden never went into lockdown, as you know, but this doesn't mean that life continued as exactly as before. And one way to look at this is to look at this mobility index provided by Google, which is based on the mobility patterns of users with activated location history in their Google accounts. And this is classified into some types of geographic locations. So we have retail and recreation areas, grocery stores and pharmacies, parks, public transport stations, workplaces, and residential areas. For robustness, I also use a mobility index provided by Apple that is that instead is based on the volume of requests for direction in the Apple Maps, which, as you understand, provide two different angles to the mobility. Because so requests for direction is not something you use when you go to work or when you go to your usual grocery store. So it gives another angle of mobility. It's more like mobility to new places. Maybe gives better measure of social interactions, because you would look for a location when you have to go somewhere new to meet someone perhaps. Okay, so what happened here? These two plots show what happens to Google mobility patterns then. And I plot parks separately in green, because this is the most, the series that has the strongest seasonal pattern, of course, and it's also on a little different scale. And here I indicate the start of the pandemic with week 11, which is when the public health agency announced a very high risk of community spread in Sweden, and then as a consequence of that, indoors event with more than 500 participants were forbidden. This is the first intervention. So then I use that as an official start of the pandemic. And here we see that clearly mobility patterns are different after this week 11. People are staying more at home, people are going less to work, even if there is variation, a lot of variation there. And people, at least in the beginning of the period, people are going less to recreational areas. This includes restaurants, bars, shopping malls, theaters and cinemas and the like. Okay, so mobility did change. Unemployment, we know that even without the lockout, the lockdown, the Swedish economy was severely hit. And this shows the number of people registered as unemployed and looking for a job. And you have to register with the Arbetsförmedlingen if you want to receive subsidies. So we can be pretty sure that everybody's registered here. We see a sharp increase that tops at about 38% compared to the past 5-year averages. And that looks pretty similar for both men and women, even if from a different starting point. And if you're curious about this starting point, we can see here that the ratio of women to men unemployed has been higher than average for the past 2 years. And then the red line plots this year's evolution of this ratio. And we see that after the start of the pandemic, this is converging towards the mean. But I don't know why. I don't know why it was higher. This requires more knowledge of the labor market that I don't have right now. Okay, another thing that I look into is alcohol sales. So Systembolaget is the monopoly distributor of alcohol beverages in Sweden. Even if we have a monopoly, this doesn't need, of course, to reflect consumption one-to-one. In fact, Systembolaget themselves, through their service, claim that consumption has not increased as much, or not at all even, due to the parallel reduction in sales of alcohol from restaurants and bars, and lower purchase from abroad, that due to the fact that Swedes did not travel as much as previous years. So, okay, this doesn't need to reflect consumption, but still, in 2019, sales from Systembolaget were estimated to be 70% of total consumption, so it's still a large share. All right. Why am I talking about alcohol? So there's one more thing about that has emerged in the past days, which is the potential increase in separations and divorces, which I'm also interested in looking at, but I don't have the data yet. Okay, so, and when it comes to crime data then, what is it that we're looking at? We have data on all crimes against a person for which the relationship between the victim and the perpetrator is classified. And this includes crimes against adults, because for minors, the relationship is not classified. And it includes attempted or planned homicides, violent assaults, battery, sexual molestations, sexual assaults, rapes, violation of integrity and privacy, both online and in real life. The definition of relationship changed over time. This makes some issues for the comparison over time that I will explain how we deal with. In particular, the definition of an intimate partner changed in 2018 to include also partners that do not live together or have never lived together. So this also goes back to Giancarlo's comment to the previous presentation. And then from January 2019, the number of other family relations. However, this has implied a coding mistake that the police is only noticed in February 2020, which is very unfortunate timing for us. But they are correcting it, and so for the time being, we have to be extra careful with just the codes of battery. Okay, so what we do is that we follow we group the crimes in three categories. We look at all crimes committed by an intimate partner, excluding battery. We look at sexual crimes separately, which are more than half of the previous category, and then we look at battery cases separately. And this is for before after comparison. When we look at correlations with socioeconomic factors, we hope that this coding mistake is not related to the patterns of mobility or patterns of unemployment, and therefore we group all the crimes committed by an intimate partner together. But for a robustness check, we also exclude battery, and we also look at sexual crimes separately. And this is, once again, victims are both women and men older than 18, and the period is from January 2018 to August 2020 at the weekend municipality level. So these are the econometric models that we use for before, after, and difference in difference comparisons. It's pretty standard. It's been used before by the previous presentations as well. We use a weak number fixed effect, which implicitly compares the same week of previous years to a week this year. And then the COVID dummy, the COVID indicator is one for all the weeks after week 11. And then in this setting, we interact with the gender of the victim as well. And a summary of results is as follows.
Maria, sorry, we have 5 minutes left.
Yes, okay, let me go directly to the table. So we see that, all crimes committed by an intimate partner, excluding battery, increase for both men and women, but significantly more for women. Okay. Sexual crimes do not increase differentially for women, and battery, they decrease for women compared to men. And this might be due to the fact that we are aggregating all the type of relations, which in principle could be going in different directions. I'm going quickly, but this is probably the more interesting part, is the mobility patterns. Similar structure here, we have mobility. So since there is no mobility, there is no mobility differentials for the weeks of the previous years, then this implies that this gamma coefficient is some kind of placebo. Because it says what happened to crime rates in 2019 in the weeks where mobility patterns in 2020 deviated from the norm. Right. So what we see here is that we don't see any significant impact on total crimes, but we do see an impact of mobility patterns when excluding battery, which is the probably the most robust aggregation. We see that reduction in transit in mobility to retail and recreation areas and to some extent grocery shopping, grocery stores and pharmacies, as well as an increase in residential mobility, increased crimes against women differentially from crimes against men. And this is not driven by sexual crimes. When we look at as a robustness to the upper mobility index, we find that basically all changes in mobility also are associated with increases in all crimes and all crimes excluding battery, but not sexual crimes. Okay, when it comes to unemployment, I have to say the rest of the analysis, first of all, I am running short of time, but it's also even more preliminary. So let me just quickly summarize. It's not associated with crimes against men, but positively associated with crimes against women. While the ratio of women to men unemployed has no significant association with crime levels. Unemployment changes week to week within a municipality are also positively associated with crimes, excluding battery, and also sexual crimes against women, significantly more than against men. However, these relationships do not change during COVID. So how do we interpret this? I'm not sure yet, but so I'm tempted to draw this preliminary conclusion. People that become unemployed because of the sudden and unexpected COVID crisis, which is unrelated to their own or their sector's productivity, are not more or less violent than regular unemployed. Which in my mind, it partly addresses the issues with selection in the unemployment to violence link. However, on the other hand, there might be more things that happen, of course, during the COVID crisis that affect the increase in crime.
1 minute left.
1 minute left. Yes, just to say that we need to dig deeper into this relation and probably interact it with other factors because they probably play a joint role. I skip the table. And similarly with alcohol, we see that alcohol sales are related to increase in total crimes and sexual crimes for both men and women, significantly more for women. And this relationship is stronger during the COVID period. But this is possibly because the sales from Systembolaget are a better proxy of consumption during this period. So, well, quickly concluding, we find limited support for some hypotheses from the literature, also in Sweden, so also in absence of a lockdown. But we need to dig more into these relationships. A lot is still open questions. Yes.
Thank you very much, Maria. Very, very interesting. And yes, so we have time for questions. So let me see, do we have questions from the audience? Please raise your hand if you have a question. So there is not, I will start with a question or with a curiosity. I wonder, it's extremely interesting what you show about the data on mobility. And of course, Sweden is an interesting case, as you pointed out at the beginning, because there has not been a lockdown. And one thing that then emerges is that mobility, therefore changes in mobility, of course, in Sweden are more endogenous than in other places. So the people who decided not to move when there was not technically an order not to, might be a different selection. So how does this affect the way in which we can interpret this? Is this a problem? Is this something that you're thinking of or that can help interpret some results, etc.?
Yes, this is something that I was supposed to say if I hadn't needed to rush. But yes, so the, of course, like you say, the voluntary nature of the Swedish lockdown or the lack thereof adds a layer of endogeneity to this relationship. Because being able to choose, of course, individuals that were more exposed to the risk of violence would naturally choose to be less at home. This is less true for workplaces and retail and recreation areas, because this was more a decision often from the workplace side or from the and of course from the restaurants could be closed or limit their clientele and so on and so forth. So less endogenous there. But yes, what I'm thinking two things. For once, this would lead to an attenuation bias. So hopefully this is still in terms of a lower bound, because yeah, the bias goes in that direction. The second thing is that I have a parallel project with other co-authors on weather. So they were looking at whether affects rule compliance with the rules. In this setting, compliance with the rule would be limit your mobility when you're advised to do so. So if we see in particular that if we do find this strong relationship, that when weather deviates from, like, if you have a particularly sunny day in an otherwise gray period, and you see everybody suddenly ignoring the mobility restrictions, an instrument for this.
Very good. Yeah. Thank you very much. Okay. And I think unless there is